We'll start with a playground from scratch and go through the code. However, you can also download a rich playground with more information for your reference. You may find the link in the instructor notes. So what does it mean for a closure to be a first-class citizen of the language? It means you can use closures just like any other type, such as ints, floats, strings, whatever. You can assign them to variables or constants, put them inside arrays or dictionaries, return them as the result of a function or closure, and even receive them as parameters of another function or closure. That last part seems a little bit weird, so let's start with the most obvious parts. First of all, we're going to assign a closure to a var or a constant. Okay, so here we are creating a closure using syntax closure, and we're assigning that closure to a constant. So that's a little bit different. And this closure just takes one integer, returns another integer, and within the body of it, this should be x, by the way, it adds 42 to x. Okay, so it's a pretty simple closure. And closures have types too. Look right here in this result sidebar, and you'll see that the type of this closure is int arrow int. It means it takes one integer and returns an integer. And we can call this closure just like we would call any function or any other closure. So let's give it a try. So the bottom line is we can use the closure that we saved into the constant f in the normal way using the regular syntax. However, try to call it passing a string as a parameter. This will cause an error, and by now you should already know what's going on. It's not the type that the closure accepts. So it works exactly as functions so far. Let's get rid of this. And now let's try something fancier. Let's put a bunch of closures inside an array. Let's see if it's possible. So here we have an array called closures with just one closure inside, and the type is, as you would expect, an array of int to int. So this defines what kind of closure we can put inside this array. As long as the closure takes one int and returns an int, we should be able to put it in there. Let's add a few more. Okay, so here we have the final array with several closures in there. All these closures have one thing in common. They have the same type. They take an int and return an int. How does the compiler know that? Because of the first one. So this sets the type of closure that can go in there. The second one over here has the full closure syntax with type information for the parameter and the return type. That's not really necessary because the compiler has that information already. So the next one avoids the type information and it works fine. The other one, the next one, doesn't have the return. Why? Because when a closure just has one statement, one line, the return is implicit. So the compiler knows that it should return x times x. And last but not least, we have this ultra simple version where we don't even provide a name for the parameter, because in Swift, closures and functions can access their parameters or arguments by the position. So $0 means position 0, the first one. So first parameter times 42 and return that. Could we call those closures that are stored in the array? Yes, definitely yes. So let's give it a try. So right here, we're iterating through the array of closures, and for each closure, we call it passing 42. And here, you can see the results. You can also see it this way, okay? Now I've got an exercise for you. Try to create an array with two closures, one that takes two integers and returns the sum as another integer. And the other closure should take two floats and return the sum as a float. Would this compile? Think why.